Welcome back. In the previous video, we've talked a little bit about variable types. And I've showed you some very basic variable types. And we had a short discussion about what it actually means to store information on the blockchain, how much it costs, the concept of gas, etc. And in this lesson, I want to give you a few more examples of some of the other variable types which are available, but I also want to put some more emphasis on the concept of more complex structure of variables. So let's start with a very simple example. I'm going to create an array. An array is a type of a container. This container will hold an amount of specific type of objects. So for example, I can have an array which is called, let's say, student names. And it will contain all the names of the students in a certain class. Let's see it in action. I'm going to declare that I have a string because the name of the student is a string. And I'm going to follow it with this type of square bracket. This square bracket tells the compiler, the Ethereum virtual environment or the Ethereum virtual machine, that there is going to be a list of strings, not just one string. I'm going to make this one public as well. And I'm going to give it a name. The name of this list is going to be student name. There we go. Now I can take this student name variable, and this student name will be indexed, and I will be able to browse through them. So let's see it in the example. This is a contract that I'm actually going to deploy. So I'm going to create a constructor function. So function, example. If you don't remember what a constructor function does, I suggest that you will watch the first video. So our constructor function is going to be quite simple. It won't take any argument, but it will set this student name variable with the name of the student. I'm going to call this student Shlomi, because that's my name. But I also have to specify what is the index number of this student. Shlomi is the first student, so the index number should be 0. The index number in Solidity always starts with 0. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the first object is object number 0. But when we are using Solidity, it is highly recommended that you will not try to manually insert the index number. Instead, you can use a very simple built-in function, which is called student name, or the name of your array, dot length and plus plus. This line over here, we look at this object, at this array student name. It will check what is the length of this array, and it will make sure that the next empty cell in this array will be allocated with this variable over here. There is another way to do it. Maybe you will prefer the other way. Once again, student name, but this time I'm going to direct the user function. So I'm going to put a dot, push, and the name of the student which I want to insert. So this one's going to be Zeltzinger. Now you can already start to see that there is some sort of a pattern here. This array object, once we defined it to be an array, it can support or it can perform a certain type of functions. And in order to reach those functions, such as the length or push, all I need to do is to put a simple dot in the middle. An array as a set of functions, I'm going to use a function by putting a dot and then calling that function using that function name. So both of those methods is valid. They are both basically do the same thing. They will both look for the next empty cell in the array and will allocate the string which I'm inserting into this cell. So let's see it in action. Let's copy the code. Contracts. Deploy a new contract, and over here in the middle, let's paste our code. There we go. I'm going to deploy this contract. I want you to see it in action. So let's deploy it. We're going to wait for a few minutes for this contract to be created, for this contract to be mined. There we go, the contract was mined. Back to contracts, and it should be down here. Here it is. Now you can see all the variables which I have inserted into this contract. They are already registered in this contract. I can watch them and I can read them. Number 3, which contains the integer 3. Number 2 contains the integer minus 2. Number 1 contains the string 1. But what we really care for is this student name over here. We can see that over here, I have some sort of a scroll bar. I can, some sort of a navigation bar. I can go up and I can go down. You can see that the first item, which is 0 over here, is called Shlomi, or it holds this string Shlomi. The second one, which is actually number 1, holds this string Zeltzinger. And of course I can add more and more strings into this student name over here. So that was a very basic introduction to arrays. And there is another type of object which I want to talk with you about, and this one is called struct. Let's do it, struct. Struct is a type of quite an unusual object, but very, very powerful. Struct will allow me to define my own objects. So let's say that I have some sort of a contract which contains information about my clients, or in this example about students. And each student basically needs to contain the same information, the same type of information. For example, I need to know what is the name of the student. And maybe I also need to know what is the age of the student. And I need to know what is the address of the student, and so on. So I can declare a struct object, and I'm going to call this one student. I can call it whatever I want, but I'm using student at the moment. And this student needs to contain, first of all, a string. And this string is going to be student name. So right now, every student that I will insert into this contract will have a student name. The next item should be, let's say, unsigned integer, which will be student age. There we go. I've used unsigned integer because it's quite obvious that the age of the student can't be a negative number. It can only be a positive number. You cannot have a student which his age is minus 3. So there is no point in allowing the user to insert any integer which is a negative integer. So this is it about the student age. I want to insert another type of variable. This one is called address. We haven't talked about address yet. Ethereum address has its own set of rules that must be followed in order to be a valid address. And this variable over here will automatically make sure that this address is a valid address, and it is a valid Ethereum address, and only if it is, only then it will actually store this address. So it is very, very useful to always use this type of variable whenever we want to store an Ethereum address. So this one's going to be the student, not name, sorry, address. And the last type of variable which I want to show you will be Boolean. And this one going to be called active. Boolean is a simple yes or no variable. It can only hold true or false statement, nothing else. So, for example, if the student is not active anymore, this Boolean, which is called active, will be set to false. The student is not active. If the student is active, if the student is still enrolled in our course, this Boolean will contain true. Is the student active? True. So this is this object called student. And I can now, I can create a new variable which will be of this type, of this student type. So I want to do it over here. I want to create a student type of variable, just as I declared any other type of variable in the top. I've declared a string variable, I've declared an integer variable, I've declared an unsigned integer variable, I've declared an array, and over here I am declaring this student variable, which I've created by myself using this struct. And I'm going to make this student variable also public. And I will give this student type of variable a name, whichever name I choose. So I choose my name, Shlomi Zeltzinger. Now my own name can be interacted as if it was a variable. And I want to show you how I can interact with this variable now. So let's take our constructor from this, from the top, from here, and let's put it at the bottom. It is always important to make sure that you are declaring the variables before actually using them in this function or in any other type of function. So we've declared this variable, this student, we've declared the student object, and we declared the variable Shlomi Zeltzinger, and I'm going to use it. I'm going to say that Shlomi Zeltzinger, let's say student name, will be equal to this is me. So let's copy this contract now. Over here in the Mist wallet, contracts, deploy a new contract. And over here in the middle, let's wait for it for a second to compile. There we go. Example. I'm going to deploy this contract. There we go. The contract was mined. Let's see it in action over here. And over here you can see I have a variable called Shlomi Zeltzinger. And the name of this student is this string we've just inserted. This is me. I can also set the student age, the address, and I can also set this Boolean, whether active or not. And I'm going to show you how to set those variables. So over here, this is quite simple. Just as we did before, we have this object called Shlomi Zeltzinger. This object has some built-in functions, which in this case will be to use this student age, student address, and Boolean active. I'm going to set the student age to be, I don't know, 50. No, I'm not 50. I'm going to make it 31. I'm going to change the address. I'm going to make it, Shlomi Zeltzinger, student address. And now I'm going to use some sort of a built-in function in Ethereum, which is quite useful to know that function. It's called message.sender. This function over here will give me the address of the sender of this message, which will basically give you the address of the one who deployed this contract or called this function, which in this case is my own private address. So I got this message sender, which will be an address, and it will be stored in this student address, which is an address in this variable which I declared, and it is called Shlomi Zeltzinger. And I also need to set the Boolean. So as a default, the Boolean will hold false, and I'm going to set it to be true, so active. And I'm going to change it from false to be true. There we go. Let's deploy this contract again. Contracts, deploy a new contract. And down here. There we go, example. And let's deploy the contract. Now let's wait for a minute. Okay, so now the contract was mined. Let's see it in action. Let's go to contracts. And over here, we can see Shlomi Zeltzinger. And this is my name, this is me, and this is my age. This is the address. It doesn't show it as an address, but this is my own private address. And if I press this button, it will take me to my test account. And this is the actual address. The Ethereum wallet already knows to display an address by the name of their user. So it just displayed it as this test account. Let's go back to the contract. And again, you can see over here as well, active. This user, this student, is active. So that was it about arrays and about structs. And I want to show you some sort of a use case, which is quite often used in Ethereum. And the idea behind this type of use case is basically to store a list of this student object, which I've created, into a single array. So I will have an index number, which will be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And each cell in this array will hold an object such as this Shlomi Zeltzinger over here. This object will either have his own name. This object will contain the name of the student, the age of the student, the address of the student, and whether or not the student is still active. And it will be quite useful if you have a list of many students and you need to have this type of information to each and every student. In order to do so, you just declare it as an array. You say that there is a student type variable which is stored in an array. It is a public array, and the name of this public array will be, I know, my students. And right now I can store into this array a list of this student which I've created using this struct object. And each one of those students in my student array will have their name, their age, their address, and whether or not they are active or not. And now, before we finish it up, I just want to talk with you about one more way in which you can use an array. An array can also be indexed using a more complex type of indexes. And we do it using something called mapping. Mapping basically means that instead of using only integers such as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 in order to index our array, I can use a more complex type of variables. And I think that for our example, the best variable to use will be address. Because again, we try to create a list of all the students, and each student has its own unique address. Some student might have the same name, for example, or be the same age, but each one will have its own unique Ether address. So using address is usually a very, very good way in order to index a more complex array. So I'm going to do so. I'm going to say that I'm going to map an address into a student. Remember, student was declared in this struct over here. I basically tell the Ethereum virtual machine that once I will insert an address into a variable, let's give this a name already. It's going to be a public, and it's going to be called my student. And I don't need this one. Let's remove this. So right now, whenever I look at a contract, I will see that I have a sort of a variable, an index type of variable, an array type of variable, which is called my student. I will be able to browse through this array. In the previous example, I was only able to browse it using integers. There was integer number 0, which was Shlomi, and then it was integer number 1, which was Zeltzinger. That was the example I gave before. But this time, I won't be able to browse through this array using an integer. Instead, I will be forced to insert the address which will correspond to this student. So let's see it in action. I'm going to take my constructor, and I'm going to put it at the end. Remember, you always need to first declare the type of variable that you are going to use. and only then you will be allowed to use them. So in my example, let's remove this. It's going to be quite simple. I'm going to tell the machine to look in the My Students array for the address of the sender. Remember, this is the address of the sender. And after it will find a cell with this index, I want it to store a student type object as we declared over here, and as we told him that he need to store in this mapping over here. So this student going to have the following fields. Pay attention, bracket, curly bracket, and a semicolon at the end. And in the middle, it's going to have a student name, which will be Shlomi. It will have a student age. There we go. And it will have a Boolean active, which will be set to true. I don't think we need to keep this student address, since we already know the address. This is the address of the cell itself. So let's now copy this code and take it to the Mist wallet. I've pasted the code. And now let's deploy it. There we go. And now let's have a look a minute at my test account. I want to take the address of this account. I want to copy it. Yes, I'm going to copy this address. Go back to contracts and let's see my latest contract over here. Right now I have this array called my students, and you can see that it asks me to insert an address. I will only be able to browse through this array if I know the address of the cell which I am looking for. I know the address because this is my address. So now if I paste this address in this cell, I get all the detail which I've inserted earlier. Student name is Shlomi, student age 31, and active, yes. So that was it. And in the next video, I'm going to talk with you a little bit more about functions, and I see you then.